This video is brought to you by Sporlan, quality, integrity, and tradition.
All right, we have a call on a walk-in cooler maintaining like 45 degrees. So come in here, we've got a thermometer in here right now, saying about 45. We come up here, it's not iced up. So we need to have a look on the roof and see what's going on up there. It's definitely blowing cold air, so we'll have to see. But one thing I will tell you is they keep leaving the door open. These dang doors, man. On top of the door issue is these boxes. See, these boxes are blocking the airflow because when I moved these two boxes right now, a significant amount of airflow started coming around here, and they have them like partially blocking this. So it's already hard enough because this walk-in's like 28 feet long. And getting the air to the other side is difficult as it is, and then you block off the fans and it makes it even worse. So even though it's not iced up on the backside, I can still see some frost in here. And it's interesting, if I look inside here, you can see some weird frost in these coils. I don't know if it'll come up on camera right now or not, but it's ever so slight inside. Like right over in here, yeah, see, it's not gonna show on camera, but there's like a little bit of ice inside the coil. And then you come over here and there's definitely some frost over here too. It's not very even, so that's interesting. You know, we could have a plugged up strainer on that TXV, but it's hard to say. We're going to go ahead and probe up on this guy and check the superheat and see what's going on. We need to get that frost to disappear a little bit too. But it could just be that they're leaving the door open so the thing just runs and runs and runs all day long and then starts to frost up, you know? So we pulled the top off the condensing unit and we're gonna go ahead and rinse this guy off. It's not filthy, but this equipment definitely needs to be cleaned. I was recently working on this one and I noticed they kind of looked a little dirty. So we're gonna clean them all, but we're gonna jump on this one right now because I have the temperature controller turned off downstairs to defrost that little bit of frost on that coil. So we'll rinse this guy off real quick. Got some of the Viper blue venom pack on here. Get that coil nice and clean. Try to hold it more straight because you're not getting the coil cleaner. There you go. Now you'll get it. There you are. You should be seeing that foam. You probably need to put a little bit more, but I think you can make it work. Just spray it on there, it's not that bad. So we'll see how this does. Worst case, we gotta pull the fan motors out, but I don't think we're gonna need to do that. But look at that stuff coming out right now. All right, so this is pretty good. I can actually see light through the condenser, so we're gonna rinse it. Gotta be careful. But yeah, this is coming through nice and dirty. They don't do normal routine maintenance, so whenever we get the opportunity at these locations, we wanna clean this equipment to eliminate potential service calls. And we are using hot water right now too, which is really nice because it's really breaking that stuff down. And it's going through. Like I said, you guys can't, but I can see right through that. Actually, you can. You can see right through it too. So I'm gonna give everything else a rinse real quick, very carefully without ruining anything. Clean the inside out, just get a little water in there. Pretty beat up. There's a lot of bird crap too, so we'll give all that a rinse and then we'll do this guy too. When you're rinsing these roofs or these condensers off, if you use the blue coil cleaner, I mean any coil cleaners, you really should be rinsing it off the roof too. It's not the greatest thing in the world for it to sit and dwell on it. At a minimum, dilute it down, but I always like to rinse the dirt out of here too, so that way it doesn't pull back up on the new clean coil, you know what I'm saying? And then I'm also getting rid of this pigeon crap. There's a bunch of that. I mean, it'll just be back because the pigeons will come back, but just trying to get rid of some of it. Clean the roof off just a little bit so we don't have to work in this nastiness. Just a little. All right, I went ahead and probed up on the condensing unit. So we've got the high side. We have liquid line temperature. That doesn't really mean a whole lot because this unit does have a receiver and this is an older unit. So it's not really gonna have very much measurable subcooling at all. Maybe a degree or two. Cool thing though, because I'm using the field piece jobbling probes, is they have that crazy wireless range. Now, you also need to have good Bluetooth, have an updated phone, you know, best case Bluetooth, what is it, 4.0, the newest one I think or something. You wanna have the best Bluetooth possible, but I'm inside the walk-in box, getting suction line pressure and suction line temperature and air temperature. So it's currently 46 degrees in that box right now. And I'm able to connect up here, so I'll be able to go back down there. Now, keep in mind when you go inside the walk-in box, it will get a little spotty because you're going through a lot of layers, right? But line of sight, you should be able to get like 1,000 feet, permitting that you have the best Bluetooth on your phone, you know, and no interference and stuff. But okay, we're gonna go ahead and turn this guy back on. We'll leave the cover off and go downstairs. It should be all defrosted. There was just a little bit of frost, and we'll check out the system operation. So yeah, we still got great connection to the roof. Way to go, field piece. High side pressure, temperature. Yeah, that's great. Okay, so we gotta turn this guy back on. All the frost is gone. So I'm just gonna go to this temp control. I put a dot where it was set at, so that way we can play with it there too. And we heard the solenoid valve kick in. We've got suction pressure. It's on and running. You always want to make sure that you always mark those controls. You never want to just go twisting on them, because you could inadvertently solve the problem without even knowing it. So always mark where they were and then play with them. And then always be cautious. I usually don't even like adjusting those very much, but in this situation I had to. So we're just gonna watch it run for a few minutes, make sure the sight glass is clear, and then watch it come down in temp, hopefully. It's only been running for a few minutes. We're still really high in temp, 45 degrees, but superheat's not too bad as far as the range. I've seen it go up to 13, come down to 10, so it's throttling where it should. I called my technician on the roof. We do have a solid column of liquid in the sight glass, so it's clear. So we're just gonna let it run for a little bit and see what happens. Again, I just caught him leaving that door open again. Like, it's broken. It needs to be replaced, but they gotta keep it closed until then. And I'm trying to get him to let me put curtain strips, but that's like pulling teeth at this place. I really don't see much wrong with this unit other than they're just leaving that damn door open. I stood outside the door for 15 minutes and closed it 4 times myself as the people walked in and out. They're just not getting it. And we're looking fine in here. I mean, you got a little bit of frost, but it's just because it's cold, you know, and there's a lot of condensation and humidity in here. So I don't see a refrigeration problem. We're still maintaining a decent superheat, 13 degrees. Again, we're still running a clear sight glass on the roof. I'm taking my probes off here. The last thing I'm gonna do is check the liquid level in the receiver just to make sure that it's got enough refrigerant for the head pressure control valve. And I'm also telling them I'm not coming back out here unless it's to install curtain strips, because I anticipate a service call this weekend because it's 45 degrees in here and I'm not gonna do it. This is just silly because they're leaving a door open, you know? So I don't have my thermal imaging camera today, but the liquid levels, right below the 3/4 mark, right above the halfway mark, I'm gonna call that good. The 3/4 mark is just a fail safe. That's the maximum amount of refrigerant you can put in the system. But if you follow the head pressure control valve charging chart, Spoiling's 90-30-1 and calculated, or if you talk to Russell who makes this condensed unit, they'll tell you that you clear the sight glass above a certain temperature and then add so much extra refrigerant. And I know that this system's right around like a third or a halfway, so I think we're good. Yeah, we're gonna wrap this one up. I'm really pressuring them to let me put some curtain strips on there until we can get a new door for this guy. And this guy does have a defrost clock, and it's accurate. It says about 2 p.m. And I think that's about what time it is right now, 2:13 p.m. So yeah, we're good on that. Does long defrost in the middle of the night and then a couple defrosts throughout the day. We're actually gonna increase that because of them leaving the door open. A couple more 15 minutes throughout the day, and then 2 really long ones in the middle of the night. So we're gonna tell them to keep an eye on it, and then I'm really pressuring them to let me put curtain strips on there until we can get a replacement door ordered for this guy.
I come up on a lot of walk-in coolers and walk-in freezers that are iced up. In this situation, this wasn't quite iced up yet, but it was on its way. The customer called saying the box wasn't maintaining temperature, okay? I saw the door being propped open, but you don't just stop there. Don't assume that's the only problem. You need to be thorough and go through everything, because it can bite you in the butt and you could find out that there's another issue too, okay? Yes, it's obvious they need to keep the door shut, but maybe there's something else going on, right? So do your due diligence, go through the equipment. In this situation, I went through everything. I went ahead and found that the condenser was dirty, cleaned the condenser. Now that could have caused some issues, but don't think that was the issue. I think the main issue was that that door was being propped open. Now, since the filming of this video was actually filmed back in November of 2021, okay? We've already replaced the entire door. Okay. We put a bolt-on door. It's a one-way door. It's not a high traffic door, or I call those dairy doors, the ones that open on the inside and the outside. I don't know why I call them dairy doors. It's just a phrase we've always used. But essentially, I think the technical phrase is high traffic door, but because they can go in and out of it. But the new door that we installed is just a standard walk-in cooler door that only opens from the outside. It only opens one way, has self-closing hinges and all that stuff. And it actually has insulation in the door. They you know, let a lot less heat infiltrate into the box. But anyways, don't just assume that it's a door issue. Go through everything. And once I went through everything, I started to notice, hey, this equipment is doing everything it can, right? And I didn't mean to sound rude or anything when I said I wasn't going to go back out to the customer, even though I was frustrated. The point that I was trying to make was I did tell the customer, look, you guys need to keep this door shut. And if you don't, this equipment is going to, or it's going to get hot in this box again. And that is what I was saying. I'm not going to come back out tomorrow because you're saying the box is hot again when there's nothing wrong. I'm not going to waste my time to drive back out there to say, shut the door, right? So that was the point I was trying to make, because it was like pulling teeth to try to get the customer to approve me to put curtain strips on that as a temporary basis. They wouldn't let me. So I gave them options. They didn't take them. I was not willing to go back out there again to tell them, hey, there's nothing wrong. There's nothing else I can do. So that's why I kind of gave them an ultimatum. It may be bad business, but that's just the way I went about it, right? They have since, like I said, let me change the door. But again, the point I can't stress enough is be thorough. Don't just assume the first symptom you see is the problem, right? If you have an iced up coil, that's a symptom of a problem. Okay. You de-ice it and yeah, it starts working, but what caused it to ice up? Okay. Is the door being left open? Is the temperature controller bad? Is the defrost clock bad? So we're there to find the root cause, the problem. We're not there to just solve a symptom. Okay. We need to be thorough technicians. We need to understand sequence of operation and go through things methodically, so that way we can figure out and be confident in our diagnosis, right? At least that's the way I approach things. I really appreciate you guys making it to the end of the video. If you haven't already, please consider checking out my website, HVACRvideos.com. We have all kinds of cool merchandise available on there, hats, beanies, sweaters, t-shirts, couple different designs, soon to be stickers. So check it out. It's a great way to help support the channel. Also, other methods, if the easiest way to support the channel is watch the videos from beginning to end without skipping through anything. If you're interested in purchasing any tools, you can go to truetechtools.com. You can use my offer code BIGPICTURE, one word. You get an 8% discount on checkout when you use that offer code, and I get a small commission. Win-win, right? You help support the channel, and you're getting tools that maybe you need. But be sure to check them out. Price shop, do your thing, okay? Don't just trust some dude on YouTube, but I really do like True Tech Tools, and they have great customer service, great people behind that business, and I'm willing to support them and work with them. It's actually great. You know, I actually went with True Tech Tools because I used to have Amazon affiliate links, and I just didn't want to support Amazon as much. I think I still do have some affiliate links, but I really don't get anything from Amazon very much at all. But I went to True Tech Tools and got less of a commission, but I was just happy being able to support a business that I wanted to help, right? And it's not I'm not losing on the deal, right? I mean, I still get a commission. It's great, but I love them as a business. They're great people. Have a very good relationship with the guys from True Tech Tools. And every time I've met them in person, they've been nothing but great people. So check it out, truetechtools.com. Also, if you want to help support the channel, in the show notes are some links to Patreon, PayPal, and YouTube channel memberships. Those are just ways to support the channel on a monthly level. So check it out. Let me know what you think. Give me some feedback down in the YouTube comments. I'd greatly appreciate it. If you have any questions, feel free to leave me a comment. Shoot me an email at hvacrvideos@gmail.com. And that's it. Be kind to one another, and we will catch you on the next one, okay?